How can I pay for college without going broke? With so many compelling reasons to go to college, including a job change, nothing can dampen your enthusiasm quite like the prospect of paying for it. Yes, tuition rates have climbed over time, as have food, gas, and housing. Yes, college tuition is a significant expense. Yes, there is a lot of talk and disagreement about how our country should solve college affordability. At many colleges, the cost of a four-year private college education has surpassed $200,000, making even the richest student want to have a rethink. The public Ivies, which are prestigious state colleges, have raised tuition even faster than the privates. An out-of-state student will pay more than $56,250 this year to attend the University of Michigan for 1 year. However, there are more options for paying for college than ever before, and that certain universities are passionately devoted to managing tuition expenses and making college more affordable. With that in mind, here are some tips for paying for college without going broke. 1. Seek out grants. Grants are available from the state and federal governments, as well as many schools and private groups, to college students who demonstrate extreme financial need. Grants are not repaid, therefore they are a fantastic alternative if you want to avoid taking out student loans. While you must complete the Free Application for Federal Student Aid, FAFSA, to apply for federal grants, many institutions use your FAFSA or CSS profile to evaluate if you are eligible for institutional funds. 2. Seek out scholarships. Scholarships are another type of college assistance that does not have to be repaid. Although the federal government does not provide scholarships, several states do have scholarship opportunities for residents who attend school in their state. Scholarships are available through your school as well as from outside organizations, and unlike grants, which are typically provided based on financial need, scholarships are typically offered based on academic accomplishment, talent, or membership in an underrepresented group. 3. Reduce your tuition costs. Consider attending a college with lesser tuition. In general, in-state schools are less expensive than out-of-state or private schools. Some colleges provide discounts based on your proximity to the campus. You may be eligible for discounts if you're a legacy student, because one or both of your parents attended the institution. Of course, education expenditures encompass more than simply tuition, but there are other ways to save. Purchase old textbooks rather than new ones. Check out your college bookstore to see what's available. When they graduate, many students sell their used books back to these retailers. Some will even rent textbooks, and used versions are frequently available from internet shops. 4. Work on lowering your living expenses. Keep careful track of your college and living expenses so that you don't need as much money. You could investigate how much it would cost you to live off campus rather than on campus. To save money, find a roommate and share off-campus accommodation or live at home. Contracts such as gym memberships and cable subscriptions should be avoided. Look for options that are reasonably priced and allow you to cancel at any time. Additionally, keep your student ID in your wallet at all times. Take it with you whenever you go shopping or to a business that will cost you money, even the coffee shop down the street. Many business establishments provide student discounts. 5. Consider an online school. Don't dismiss the option of attending an online school. Tuition can be substantially lower, often as much as 50% lower, and classes are usually identical to those you'd take in a traditional classroom. You can also study and attend when it is convenient for you, allowing you to work and study simultaneously. 6. Maintain schedule flexibility. Some degree courses, such as engineering, are more intense than others, making it difficult to work while attending classes. Consider attending school part-time for these programs so that you can continue to work part-time. Part-time students, on the other hand, may not have the option of living on campus, making it more difficult to participate in college social activities. Also, if you have student loans that require you to be in school at least half-time, be sure you meet these requirements so you don't have to repay your loans early. Another alternative is to take a year or two off after high school to work full-time and accumulate enough money to pay for college. If you don't want to put off education, you could take classes in the evenings and on weekends while working full-time throughout the week. 7. Save some more. The sooner you start putting away money in a savings account, the better. It's never too late to start when you start applying to colleges. Choosing a bank account designed exclusively for a college student might also help you save money because fees are sometimes reduced. Consider certificates of deposit, CDs, which provide higher interest rates than standard savings accounts. CDs often have a penalty for early withdrawal, which may motivate you not to touch the money before you need it for college. 8. Seek out fellowships. A fellowship, like grants and scholarships, does not have to be repaid. They are usually provided by your school and are only available to students pursuing a specific field of study. This sort of support is often designated for graduate or doctoral students, and it is contingent on work or research commitments. Find out what fellowships are available to students in your major by contacting the head of your department. 9. Blend work with study. Work study, like a fellowship, entails working a job at your school or in the community. The distinction is that it is not restricted to a single field of study. The federal government supplements the majority of work-study programs. However, some states also finance similar programs. In either scenario, you'll need to fill out the FAFSA to see if you qualify. Work-study programs are not available at all institutions, so check with your school's financial aid office to see whether it's an option. The amount you are eligible for is determined by how fast you file the FAFSA, your financial need, and the institution you attend. According to a Sallie Mae survey, the average amount students received through the Federal Work-Study Program in 2016 was $2,469. 10. Go for student loans from the federal government. If you must borrow, you should probably start with federal student loans. They are provided by the Department of Education and have lower interest rates and more flexible repayment schedules than private student loans. Depending on the sort of loan you want, you may also be able to qualify without a cosigner. The amount you can borrow is determined by your academic year and loan type. To apply, you must also complete the FAFSA. 11. Go for private student loans. If you have exhausted your federal student loan choices, you may wish to consider private lenders. They often provide larger loan amounts than government loans, but you must have strong to exceptional credit or a creditworthy cosigner to qualify at a competitive rate. Private student loans often do not have as many flexible repayment alternatives as well as deferment and forbearance programs. 12. Look into transfer credits. Find out if you can transfer credit hours if you've already attended college or completed professional or military training courses. If your credits are transferable, you may be able to finish your degree sooner and more affordably. You will be given extra credit. Take one or more college-level examination program, CLEP exams. These standardized tests provide college credit for less than $100 for each exam. Speak with an academic or admissions advisor about life experience or portfolio credit, which allows you to receive course credit for documented college-level employment experience. 13. Consider income sharing arrangements. This one-of-a-kind alternative to student loans has grown in popularity in recent years. You essentially borrow money for college that you pay back with a portion of your wage once you have a job after graduation, which is offered by both schools and private companies. 14. Consider employer-sponsored tuition aid programs. Companies such as Publix, UPS, Starbucks, Walmart, and Chipotle have all begun to offer tuition aid to their employees. They will normally contribute a set amount per year towards your tuition and fees. Some have a lifetime cap on how much they're willing to cover, while others don't. Inquire with your employer's human resources department to see if it has any help programs for college students. 15. Don't be shy to seek assistance. Speak with your employer about how you might help alleviate cost. Thousands of employers provide financial assistance in the form of tuition, books, and even paid time off for attending class. According to the United States Department of Education's National Center for Education Statistics, Adult Education Survey of the 2005 National Household Education Surveys, 86% of full-time workers got some form of financial support, tuition, books, or materials from their employer for formal work-related courses or training. Furthermore, IRS legislation authorizes and permits employers to pay up to $5,250 in tax-free tuition assistance. Final thoughts. According to the poll, between 70 and 80% of all college-bound high school students were admitted by their first-choice college last year. But the issue is not so much how to get into college as it is how to pay for it once you're there. If you take advantage of one or two of the tips in this video, you stand a better chance of completing college without going broke or knee-deep in debt. And that's that for today. Like this video and subscribe to our channel to get more helpful tips from us. All the best!